guys. My name is Roberta Peel from Oregon Trail Silver, and today we're going to be making some big, huge, giant cuffs, or a big, huge, giant cuff. So these are a couple of them that I've done previously. Both of these are fine silver. As you can see, they have rails along the outsides of them. Those are sterling silver. I'm going to explain it to you as we go. All right. So this right here is a 2-inch. This right here is a 1.5-inch, and I'm getting ready to make another 1.5-inch. So for this one, I've chosen my Regal Crosses textile texture plate. This is one of my Oregon Trail Silver exclusives. I have about 5 ounces of fine silver that's been rolled out into 18 gauge sheet, and I'll probably end up using all of it. Maybe need a little bit more, we'll see. This is a Ron Landis skull impression die. This one's from PotterUSA.com. And then I'm going to be using a nice little faceted, I say faceted, it's actually a pretty good size, but it's a faceted labradorite. This one came from Michelle Bird Adams. And then some Jamming Gems garnets, probably just for the eyes of the skull. Keep in mind that when I do this stuff, I could switch it up as I go. I just kind of play with things. The first thing I did was pick a stone and then just said, what would go well with this, and put it all together. So 18 gauge rolled fine silver, and we also have, there's I'd say probably close to just over 2.5 feet, maybe 3 feet of 6 gauge half round sterling silver wire. Okay, you can go bigger in this if you wanted to. You can go down to 4 gauge, but I found that I really like the 6 gauge. Anyhow, so this right here is going to be our rails, okay? So in order to get started, we're going to go ahead and I'll measure everything out, slap on a hallmark, and then get going. Okay, so next up, I've got my Potter USA bench here. One of the tools I promised that we'd go over as we went along. So what I've done, instead of actually doing a scribe and drawing the lines and trying to square it off, this thing actually does a great job of cutting everything really nice and level. So I'm actually going to start off just kind of slicing off. If you guys notice, this is kind of an odd shape. So what I've done is I've kind of just used a little marker. You can use a scribe if you want. And, you know, marked it off where I think that there's going to be sufficient space for a nice rectangular piece. So first things first, I'll line this up right here. Always watch your fingers when you do this, okay? There's that. I'm going to give this one right here a little extra space, and there's a reason why. Okay, so now that I've gotten that, I'm going to shear it off to the side. Now, as long as everything is level up here, everything should come out nice and square. So just line your blade up, make sure everything's pushed up. Okay, there's that, and now we're going to slice this part here down. That way everything is nice and square. You notice that I haven't annealed anything or done anything with it yet. So I do my cuffs at 6 inches. Because, well, there's a few reasons why I do them at 6 inches. First of all, it's the right size for me. Second, it's a pretty easy size to obtain. There we go. So this should be a nice, near perfect 2x6. So next thing we're going to do is we'll anneal this up and roll it through the mill. Okay, so annealing is a fairly simple process. This is a 12-inch annealing pan. It's one of my favorites for doing like a lot of annealing work. I also have a smaller 7-inch as well. Anyhow, so I use, the only time that I switch over to acetylene and oxygen for a torch is going to be when I use my Victor torch for casting, because it just melts like that. Now, otherwise, I use straight up acetylene because it's easier, it's cheaper. You know, you run out of oxygen pretty quickly most times, so this way I don't have to worry about it. So this is a Smith Handy Heat acetylene torch, and all I'm going to do is I'm just going to heat it up until I see it kind of start to glow pink. With fine silver, it's a little harder to see than it is, for example, with sterling, because sterling is going to have a lot of oxidation going on when you do this. You get a lot of fire scale. Fine silver, not so much. I mean, not completely not, but By the way, this torch, like I said, is a Smith Silversmith or Smith Handy Heat. The only difference between those two, if you go on to CyberWeld and go to try and pick one up, is the size of the tips. Okay? So these tips right here, the Silversmith comes with all the small ones. The Handy Heat comes with the big ones. You can get one or the other and then turn around and buy the tips later on. So I'm just kind of like heating it up until I see just a real light pink glow. There's other tricks that you can do. For example, if you have, you don't want to heat it up too much past that because it'll melt. But if you have like a permanent marker, you could put that on there, but it's not always a guarantee. You know, put a marker on it and just heat it up until the marker burns off. It's not an exact science, but I just heat it up until it glows pink and then let it sit in the annealing pan. There we go. Let it sit in the annealing pan for a few minutes and then we'll quench it. Alright, so this next step, we're going to be actually rolling our silver through the mill. As you can see, I have a manila folder, and on the inside of it, I have my texture plate. I'm going to put my metal over it. Now, I kind of do want this centered, but I found that if I actually tape the metal over it, then it leaves tape impressions in the back of it. So instead, what I'm going to do is line it up as carefully as I possibly can, but I'm actually going to keep it closer to the top because as it rolls through, the metal actually stretches down. It's another good reason to stick with a hammer and lead, but you know what? We're just going to do the rolling mill because it's quicker. So try and get it lined up as best as I can. I'm going to crank this baby open just so everything slides in. You want to make sure that your metal and your steel plate are all in there, and then I'm going to torque it down as hard as I can. So my I know you can't see it, but my tick marks right now are reading at 27. So I'm going to pull it back out. And I'm going to close it down to we'll do 32. You want to make sure that your metal itself is actually going to go through. That's kind of the important thing. The hard part now is just making sure that it goes in there as straight as possible and just roll it through. You can only use your manila folders once. Here we go. Real nice, awesome texture. So now what I'll have to do is measure this back out to 6 inches again, because it stretched out, and then slice off the end. All right, so this next part I'm gonna use, I actually only have a soft, brand new charcoal block, but I always like sticking with a brand new one, or at least a perfectly flat edge. Because this one's a soft charcoal block, you can see I've run binding wire all the way around it, really kind of torqued it on. That way, if that block cracks, which they have a tendency to do, it'll be all right. So these ones right here are little pieces. These are just over 6 inches each, little pieces of 6-gauge sterling silver wire. Their purpose is to see to it that as sterling silver can get hard, actually gets harder than fine silver. The purpose of the rails is, number one, is decorative. Number two, secretly number one to us metal artists, is to provide stability, because as the sterling silver gets shaped and it gets hardened, it's less prone for bending and deformation. So, as you can see, I've got a slight overhang on both sides. Oop, there you go. Now you can see it. And then what I'm going to do is straighten it out as best as I can by hand. This is a Richard Barrett technique. If you guys don't know who Richard Barrett is, check out Let's Cab Opals, one of our amazing admins on Let's Talk Jewelry, or Let's Make Jewelry. And then I've got my acetylene torch again. Make sure nothing on your bench is flammable. And I'm just gonna, yeah, I see you can already hear it cracking. I'm just gonna run my heat all the way up and down until it turns red hot. I have crosslock tweezers just to kind of force it down so that it's flat. Don't melt it. There we go. Then we'll set that one aside. It's much straighter now. We'll set that one right there aside and do the other one. Okay,
So in this next step, we're going to, we went ahead and fluxed our silver pieces. If we have to add more, we'll do it as we go. And then I have some hard solder that's in a wire. It's kind of fun doing it this way, but it's definitely a pain in the butt, so be patient with yourselves. You could always pick soldering on or put your pallions on and do the sweat solder thing, but... So I'm going to go ahead and heat these up and flow the flux. Probably start with the front one. I'm just going to kind of get them a little red hot. There we go. Back the torch off. Get it hot. Keep in mind your heat control as you go. Don't worry about how pretty it doesn't look. Nobody's gonna see it anyway. I am really bad at this. So as you can see, about a 4-inch piece will get plenty of solder on this whole thing, and then just let it flow. Then go ahead and do your other one. So now that we actually have the first two pieces have their solder on them, we're going to go ahead, move everything flammable out of the way, always a good idea. We're going to go ahead and flux the edges of our fine silver sheet. Crank the torch on. Now you notice how I have this, you notice how I actually have this sitting on a screen. There are some little weights in the back. There's a reason for it. And then I also have my cross-lock tweezers. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to flow the flux, and then I'm going to pop those two rails on. And then solder them on. And as I solder them on, it's a good idea to press and hold, remove the flame, keep holding it for a second, and then keep moving it up as once you get the heat up to temperature. So just to demonstrate, we're gonna flow the flux first. Now you notice I always start from the bottom. Always heat from the bottom. I'm not too worried about that, about the fireside yet, because we're not doing them both at once. I'm not that good. I'm going to flip the torch over and draw that heat up. Get it to glass over. There we go. Once it's all bubbled and glass over, we're going to go ahead, now that our rails have cooled off, and we'll go ahead and place them and line them up on the top. Now, to solder on the rails, I went ahead and switched to a different torch, and there's a reason for that, or a different size torch. This one right here is the biggest tip I found for this part in particular. The bigger, the better. But you need a lot of heat to do this. So I've got the back of my screen is being held down by just a couple pieces of kiln props, ceramic kiln props. Now you're going to find that it's going to slide around a little bit. Don't use a titanium pick for this part. Because if you do, it'll just kind of mess you up a little bit. So all I'm doing is I'm really heating up this bottom part. Now I'm going to flip it over and draw the heat back up. And start a little bit closer to the middle. Keep your heat moving. That sterling silver is going to melt if you don't. And start looking for the for signs of a solder flash. As you do this, sometimes it's a good idea to run your heat in the middle. Once I see the solder is flowing in one spot, I'm going to press down and take away the heat. And then just move it right on down the line. Just check it every so often. Make sure nothing's desoldered on you. Notice I've got my flame right here on the edge. I'm trying to get both at once. So go through and make sure everything's adhered. That should do it. So we're gonna let this cool down and we're gonna do the next rail. Okay, well, this part right here is still hot. I'm just gonna go ahead and brush on a little extra flex. It's not gonna hurt it. In fact, it'll probably do more harm or do more good than harm. So keep in mind that when you're soldering rails on like this, that what you're gonna find is that the solder is not gonna flow down into the crevices of your design. And that's okay. I mean, it's good to have 100% contact. It's always best. But you know what? As long as there's contact across the entire piece and, you know, in decent increments, you'll be okay. So we'll go ahead and blow the flux. It might even be too much flux. It probably is, but it'll clean on. Just blast it over. Take our other rail, and it's really hard to get these even. That's why I keep telling you guys, I'm not a master, I'm not an expert by anyone's standards. This rail right here is a little bit off, no big deal. All right, there actually looks pretty good. All right, got my cross locks. So again, start from the bottom so you can draw your heat up. Heat rises, that's why you want to do this. Now a lot of people, there's an argument over the screen that I'm using right now, because steel is a heat sink. Well, yeah, steel is a heat sink, but it's got to get put out somewhere, right? Heat rises, so if you're putting something on one of these, the majority of your heat when it disperses away from the steel is going to go up anyway, so who cares? It's kind of what you need it to do. Alright, so we'll get this good and hot underneath. And you notice I'm trying to avoid the edges until last. It's because they'll melt. And I like to get about eye level so I can see where everything is at. Thank you. So proper heat control is an absolute must when you're doing this kind of thing. What you'll find is that the closer that you get with your torch, the more heat you're putting out, the farther away you have to draw your torch back, the less heat you have to worry about putting out. That looks good and solid. So the farther away that you draw your torch, the less heat that you'll be putting out. So if it looks like you're just starting to melt that sterling, don't touch metal when it's pissed off at you. If it looks like you're just starting to melt that sterling, draw your heat back and kind of move it away just a little bit. Enough to be sure that that heat is continuing to go where you want it to go, but not so much to where it's drawing all the heat away. Okay, so let's say right here on the ends, once I see that that sterling is just getting to that melting point, draw the heat back. Kind of pull it over here, heat up around the outside so that heat gets sucked back in as soon as you touch the torch back closer to it, okay? All right, so there's those parts of the rails. We'll go ahead and get the other ones cut, and then I'll show you how to file them and solder them. Okay, so one of the things that I had forgotten to do is hallmark the back, and you always want to hallmark the back before you actually start soldering the rails on, but this actually works out because I can show you guys a little cheat. Now, this is a hallmark, and you guys know that I make stamps, but this is actually from Sandy Sturgeon. I really hope that I can get some of the detail of this little gorgeous, gorgeous stamp in. So Sandy had asked me for my brand, and I showed it to him, and he had surprised me and made this. It is one of the best made stamps I've ever seen. He does everything by hand. So here's my hallmark, and I'll show you guys how I fix this little oopsie. So the first thing that I want to do, you notice I'm not cutting off the ends of the rails yet, is I'll measure it out. It's about exactly 6 inches. And then all I'm going to do is put a mark on the 3. Exactly 2 inches. So right about there, right here is where I want my hallmark to go, because that's where my stone's going to go. So what I'm going to do is I have just a little metal blank. Just line it up right there. Get my hammer. Because see, now it keeps the rails off. If you try and do this on its own, you can do this with like a metal punch, the bottom side of a metal punch and a vise. But if I try to do this after the fact, then I'll ruin the rails. So I'm going to center it. And leave my little mark. There we go. Didn't really do anything to the top. And before I solder the stone on, I'll have to hammer that flat with an nylon hammer. But anytime you you do this, what you're gonna find is you'll leave a negative impression, okay? So that's what that is. But here is my hallmark from Sandy Sturgeon. Isn't that nice? Okay, so now that that's done, we're gonna save the rails for last. I have a tendency to do that. And then, the end parts of the rails for last. I do have a tendency to do that. I don't know why, I just do. And then we'll go ahead and we'll switch on over to some impression dies, okay? Okay, so at this point I have my impressions are all pressed out and sawed out. I did make a video of hand sawing these out or doing the impressions. I'll post a link at the end of the video so that you guys can see how to make your impression dies from Kevin Potter. And as far as the sawing goes, you know, it's no disrespect to anybody, but if you're attempting something like this and you can't saw, then I would definitely recommend working on that first. There's a lot of videos of that available as well. So the other thing that I had done, which there are also videos of, is I'd made a serrated bezel for the Labradorite. This is using Jim Brandvik's serrated bezel indexing tool. He calls them the Bez Jaws and the Top Jaws. These are some really, really great handy tools to have. And then he's got the serrated bezel indexing tool. These are amazing, by the way. And again, I'll post links of videos on how to actually use those and where to get them from at the end. So what I've worked out from here, and I'll zoom in so you kids can see,
is we'll have this right here put on the center. We'll have these little guys right here on the sides. I'll show you how to curve them and form them. Okay, so for this next part, we're gonna go ahead and we're gonna clean up the edges of the stampings as well as the cuff itself. Oop, I don't know how that happened. So what I'm gonna start with is a medium coarse wheel from Rio Grande. And all I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take it at 45 all the way around, okay? When I sawed these out, I left a little bit of an outline on the outside so I could do this. This way, nothing's sharp, nothing's cutting anybody. See the difference in the edges? This right here is still really sharp. This right here has been nice and softened. You run your thumb around it, make sure there's nothing that's really gonna catch. And it doesn't feel very sharp. Okay, so now you wanna go ahead and do the same thing to this one right here, okay? Okay, so now that I have both my Ron Landis skulls cleaned up, I'm gonna work on the edges, just the outside edges right here. I'll work on the other edges when we're done, okay? So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna go across this way, okay? And then I'm gonna take it at a 45 and just clean up the sharp edges along that back side right here. Makes it easier to form. Give it a zip. And then run your thumb on it again just to feel it, make sure it's not sharp. So if you feel the edges, it's not sharp at all. It feels really good. It'll be really comfortable. Make sure you wear a mask. This stuff kicks up a lot of dust, so you don't want to breathe in. So anyhow, I'm going to do the other side, and then we'll show you guys how to form it, and then we'll start forming everything else and soldering it on. Okay, so the next step, we've got everything all pickled, made sure our solder joints are good and everything. Our next step is to... Now I'm going to snip off the ends just because I was too lazy to do it earlier. And really all I'm going to do is this. I mean, you could hand saw them off. It's not a big deal. Just keep in mind if you keep your scrap like I do to remelt it and everything, just keep in mind that that's sterling, so don't mix your scrap. And I don't mind just snipping it off this way because it's going to get ground down eventually anyways. So the next little tool that I'm going to show you that I have, it's super handy, this is a bracelet bender by Joni Kisro. It's such a time saver. I mean, I could spend 20 or 30 minutes with my mandrel and hammering and making sure everything is even. Joni just knocked it out of the ballpark with this one, made it so easy, and you don't have to worry about your rails getting crimped. So we're going to open it up so that the whole thing fits in. And what I like to do, I'll show you on this side, I suppose. I'm not even gonna like clamp it down a whole lot. I'm gonna go ahead and line the ends up just a little bit. And then just kinda, just a little, very light touch on the screws. Make sure everything is even back here so that everything is even in the front. Okay, now watch this. Saves so much friggin' time. And then you could do your fine tuning later if you really need to. Now, because of the rails being soldered on, it's already annealed. So we're gonna curve one side, Don't worry, we're not finished. This is one that I'm still working on learning, but with the one that I had already made with this, oh, it was awesome. And I'm not torquing it down. Off. And so now all I have to do is just kind of go back in on the ends. And this is the part where I form it to fit me. But she really did knock it out of the ballpark with this one. Now I'm going to put this about halfway in so that I can finish my bend. I mean, I guess I could have started with that, but yeah, with all the heat from soldering on the rails, you should be good. So put it in about halfway, and I'm not going to torque it down really hard, just make sure everything holds still. There we go, I'll finish off the inside. Let's do this again. So I probably could have started with this. Make sure everything is even. Bend it in. And at this point, now I can just go ahead and manipulate it to fit on my wrist. Now the trick to these cuffs is you want to make sure that you can slip it on and off with ease, okay? Now it's still going to be a little bit on the tight side for the opening, and I'm just going to manipulate it a little bit by hand. Anyhow, it's still going to be a little bit on the tight side when you slip it in and off, or on and off, and that's actually okay. But the idea here is that you don't want your clients to have to, you know, bend it and pull it out, and bend it and pull it out, and you don't want to have to do that. Because what happens, and I've seen this on a bracelet that I have, what'll happen is that with the constant bending, it always is going to bend in and out in one place, and it ends up getting work hardened. Goes past work hardened, it gets brittle, and it starts to crack all the way down. So now that I have it right where I want it, minus the inside, I'll probably take an Allen hammer too on a mandrel. But now that I have it right where I want it, I'm going to go ahead and start forming the sides to match. Okay, so we'll show you that next. All right, before we actually form these to the cuff, what you're going to want to do, and you want to do this no matter what you use, okay? I'm going to do the same thing for the little flowers, okay? Take, this is 220 grit sandpaper, you know, just take 180, 220, something like that, and then very, very carefully rub the backs of it. Make sure that you get it good and even. There really is a method behind the madness for this. So what you're going to find when you do this, and you want to check this with every one, is that these sharp edges back here on the inside, what that's going to do is it's going to go ahead and sand them down flush so that you actually have a place for your solder to make contact when you sweat solder these on, because that's what we're going to do. So double check and make sure that there's enough of a lip to be able to solder the whole thing down flat. Do it any way you got to do it. Just make sure that you've got a lip going all the way around, a good lip, because you got to make sure you got that contact. Same thing if you're using conchos, whether they're handmade or from Jim Brandvik's conchos or bought from Janie Mills off from her shop. See? You can see now that there's a little bit of a lip on there. Okay, so what we're going to do, we're going to form them, and then we're going to go ahead and do a sweat solder technique again. All right? So do that with both of them. All right, so our next step is going to be to take our bezel. Now, another wonderful thing about Joni's bracelet benders, you see it's still out, it's not going anywhere yet, we're not done with it, is that it actually creates kind of a flat spot so you don't have to do your cuff on a fully domed, full dome. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead, find my center mark, which I kind of feel like I got lucky in that cross being where it is. And you can do this with the scribe, but I'm doing it with a permanent marker because I just need a general, idea, general area of where this bezel is going to get soldered on eventually, just right around the sides. Okay? And don't worry too much about the black marks. Trust me, as soon as you heat this up, they're gone. So anyhow, looks pretty good. And so now what we're going to do is you want this right here to be able to form to your cuff. So I've already annealed these. Went ahead and cleaned up the backside. And I just have a little rubber mallet. And I'm going to start from the top. I'm going to set it right over the top, and I'm just going to give it a few taps. Now, I'm not hammering the crap out of it. I'm just a few taps. It's annealed fine silver. Trust me, it doesn't take much. And yet, I'm using fine silver for this part. And all I'm going to do is just hammer it down until this thing makes contact all the way around and about where I want it to be on the bezel. So it looks like I can curve it down a little bit more. And you don't want to go straight off from the, and make sure that it's level, like straight up and down. Make sure it's kind of right in the center of like a crosshairs, because you want it to curve with a bracelet. Okay, now it feels like I got just a little bit too much, so I'm just going to push it in. So it looks pretty good. So what I'll probably end up doing is I'll go ahead, as you can see, it's not making full contact in the very center, just because it's curving straight and then there's a little bit of a bow to this. I found that there's always going to be a little bit of a bow. So what I'll do is I'll do a sweat solder and I'll go ahead and I'll tack it top and bottom and then I'll hammer it back down and then I'll solder the rest of it on, okay? You could do that, or you could put it back on here and hammer it around. So I'm going to do the same thing to the other one. So now that we have our little guys formed, at least to the best that you can get them, a lot of times they're going to be, fitted perfectly to one side, but for some reason with Joni's bracelet bender, well, for some reason it's because she's brilliant, these are actually formed very nicely to either side. So anyhow, the next thing that we're going to go ahead and do is take your bezel, whether you're making one out of fine silver or you're making it out of sterling silver, any kind of bezel wire that you have, gallery wire, it doesn't matter. This is really thick, it's 18 gauge. I almost went with 16 on this one, but I got lazy. So I'm gonna rub this. You notice I'm putting my whole palm over it. I wanna apply even pressure all the way around. So what I'm doing is I'm making sure that it's even on the bottom and it has good contact. There we go. And while you're here, if you want to get your sandpaper out of the way, just I'm going to do the same thing with all of my other embellishments. And just make sure that there's good contact all the way around. So you can do that with all of your embellishments. But I'll save time and do that later. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to slip my bezel right back in where it was. And make sure, and this is my little trick to doing it on curved bezels. Monster. Yeah, he's got to make an entrance out. So now what we're going to do, okay, well, if you want to say hi, right here. Say, get put right here.
Hi, hi.
Okay, now go away. Okay. Yeah, you know he's got to make himself known. Anyhow, so I'm going to put it right where I wanted it to go, and what I usually like to do with these is I'll just go ahead and push down just to kind of give it a little bit of extra curve. This one right here with Joni's bracelet bender, I mean, there's really no need for it, but or at least not much of one. So now what we're going to do is I'm going to finish cleaning up all the rest of my little embellishments, make sure that there's a spot for all of them to have their full contact, or at least, full contact all the way around. And then I'll go ahead and we'll solder on the bezel, and I'm probably going to add a little something going around the bezel. Okay, so now we get to the fun part. I have an annealing pan, I have two annealing pans. This is just how I do it. You can set it up any way you want to. No, this is not kitty litter. It is pumice for soldering. Now, the first thing that you want to do is make sure everything looks level, it looks even, it all looks lined up. I went ahead and fluxed it all, and I'm probably going to have to realign that bezel after I... Actually, let's do this. Let's go ahead and flow the flux first. I always feel safer doing that. So I'm just going to go ahead. I've got it propped up in the annealing pan. All I'm going to do is glaze my flux over. We're going to do a little bit of pick soldering here in just a second. You notice I go underneath first so I can draw the heat up. I'm not trying to solder anything just yet. I'm just trying to get that flux to flow. But I always go underneath because it'll draw heat up. Here we go. Once that's all nice and glazed, then I'll go ahead and pop that on. Oh, and while you're at it, don't touch your metal when it's pissed off at you. Ha ha ha. Okay, so make sure it all looks good. Looks even. So my little trick here, once I get it all even, and that other flux on the bezel, because it's still hot, is starting to really bubble up too, which is good, because we want it to get past that point before we actually apply heat. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to... I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to pick solder and just kind of tack on the ends, okay? And then I will go all the way around, but I really want those ends to stay right where they are. So I'm using my big torch again. Meet me up underneath. This is medium solder. I use hard solder on the bezel, and I use hard solder on the rails on the outside. Don't shift anything. Just eyeball it as I line it up. Some people measure it, I don't. Okay. Now I'm going to go ahead and draw the heat around the bottom. And what I'm trying to do is I'm starting from the bottom. You notice I'm going from the outside ends, right? Going all the way around, and then I'll heat up the ends, just kind of glaze over the top, because even though it's 18 gauge bezel, you really don't want to melt anything. And then I'll just go ahead and give it a couple flashes over the top. And then just be careful and watch your rails. They're sterling, it's got a lower melting point, even just by a few degrees, but they will melt. And if it seems like it's still not getting hot enough to flow your solder, go back underneath. And then try and draw the heat up some more. There we go. Now we've got some solder flowing. I'm just going to finish it off right here. Thank you. catch that sterling.
There we go.
Hey, I love that pretty little flash. So that's not really a whole lot of solder right there on the inside. Really, I just wanted to tack it on. Because my next step, I'm going to go ahead and make a ring to go around the outside of the bezel out of some decorative wire. We'll go ahead and do that next as this cools down. And then we'll pop it over and then we'll finish soldering the inside of it as well as the outside all at once, okay? Okay, so this is the wire design that I've chosen to go around the bezel. I've always loved this. I think it'll look great. Kind of give like an elegant look to an already gorgeous cuff in the works. So all I'm going to do is just kind of measure all the way around it. Now, yes, I could have done this beforehand, but I didn't want to smush the bezel. I wanted the bezel to stay the way that it was. And I'll bring it around. And I always give myself just a little bit of extra. There we go. Just a little bit of extra. I'm going to mark it and then remember that I cut it on the outside. But I give myself a little bit of extra because I want to be able to file it down. So we'll cut it right on the outside. And for those of you guys who like this bezel wire, it is gorgeous. This is what it is. Okay, it's the bead and twist pattern wire, sterling silver. 101411 from Rio. Okay. So now I'm just going to go ahead and file the ends. And I'm going to use hard solder on this one. Hard solder is always the best way to go whenever you're doing a single piece. Lots of reasons for that. Hard solder won't come apart as quickly. I hope you guys don't mind my choice in music. I listen to a lot of old shit. Apparently it's old shit now. Okay, just kind of bend it in. At this point I'm not too worried about the shape. Just kind of more worried about the size, so we'll double check that. You know what they say, measure twice, cut once. I'm going to usually use like a rocker bezel on the bench just to work it around the ends. Okay, we got it measured out, and it's our seams are locked together nicely. So we're just going to go ahead and flux it up. Switch out torch tips because that's important right now. We don't need something huge. As you can see, I have a little piece of hard solder right there. Oops. You don't require a whole lot of torque on that. Okay. So flow your flux first. For those of you unfamiliar with pick soldering, you know I do it a lot. I always heat up the flow the flux first, then heat up the pick, and then touch the pick to the solder. And then just drop it where you want it. And I like to go around a little bit. Just watch and be careful that you don't melt anything. There we go. Easy peasy. Okay, so in order for me to be able to fit this on, and I know it's going to be a really tight fit, which is kind of what you want, I have a little rocker bezel right here. And I'll pick a side. That side looks really good. Now we'll pop it off. Stretch it over the top to kind of shape it. And if you have a really hard time getting it over and around, it's because this is really super thick stuff. Okay. Oh yeah. That's the kind of fit that you want. So the purpose of this, besides being decorative, I'm just going to go ahead and make sure it's got a little lip underneath there. So aside from being decorative, if you have a curve that you're trying to solder on. This one doesn't have much of one, but it still has one. As long as the top and the bottom of your bezel and maybe a little bit along the sides are actually soldered, What this will do when you solder it on, and this is one of the very few times you'll see me use paste solder anymore. I've actually really steered away from it a whole lot over the last couple of years. I love it, but it's still very fragile hold. And you don't really need, you know, a really tight, terrible, you know, globs of solder on this part. So I'll actually use paste solder. And I'll go around all along the inside of it. What that's going to do after I push that down and I put the paste solder on and we solder it on, I'll push it down and it'll actually adhere the decorative wire to the bezel. And then at the same time, simultaneously adhering the bezel itself to the back plate and to your actual cuff. Okay? So make sure that you... Alright, so we're going to go ahead and take our paste solder. And you know what? Be a little generous about it. This stuff, it's unlike regular solder, because of the flux and the organic compounds on the inside of it, you'll find that it actually burns kind of dark. Like it'll turn a little black before it actually does any good. Anyhow, but because of that, it doesn't just like glob up like solder will on paste. And solder will actually spread, don't get me wrong. But this stuff will, it's got a serious spread to it. And if you're a newbie and you're watching this, I would definitely recommend checking out a book by Kate Ferrant Richborg. I'll put that in the credits as well. Kate's book, it comes with a DVD, and she actually shows you the difference between the different solders. Okay, so now we're just going to go ahead and press that down, and I want to make sure that it's down all the way. So I've got my rocker bezel. I'm going to start on this side. I'm going to use my thumb and hold it down and switch over to the other side. And that'll help seal in the curve, and it'll also help seal in the bezel. Just double check. Make sure it's down as far as it can go, all the way around. Okay. Okay, so for this next part, we are going to go ahead and flex up our skulls. Ooh, not that thick. Gee, golly. So we're going to flex up these. And just keep in mind that if you decide you're going to make a project like this, you don't have to use skulls. You can use pre-made embellishments, no big deal. But I'm really going to just kind of take it easy on the inside, but make sure that it gets all the way to the outside. But the process is still the same, whether you make your own embellishments or not. No big deal. And I don't know if you guys can see this. Here's an indication of what parts are touching when I push it onto the cuff. Anything that's got like a burnished look to it, that's where I'm going to be putting the solder, as well as along the outside edges, because I really want to tack these on pretty good. You don't want these falling off if you're doing these for a client. And I don't, but I still don't want them falling off. I really like my work. Okay, so I've switched over to the medium head tip. Just so you guys know, the small one, or the medium one that I'm using is the 80, it's a size 2. The small one that I'm using is a 0. And the large one that I'm using is size 3. Okay? So now we got that out of the way. Let's go ahead and make some fire. Alright, so this is me pick soldering again. I'm going to go ahead and flow my flux. As you can see, I've got a ton of solder down here. Get it all nice and glassy. Heat up my tip. Touch it to a piece of solder. I'm going all the way around the edges. And it's okay if it flows, because really, I mean, that's the objective anyways, right? Just watch your silver and make sure that you don't melt it like this happened to me in the past. you can see, I'm being super duper liberal. But I'm also making sure that it flows. I missed the edge. I'm going to go back. There we go. Make sure it flows all the way around. Because I'm certain it's also going to stick a little bit on the inside as well. I'm just going to put a couple on the inside. Okay, so that one right there is nice and done, and now we're going to go ahead and do the other one. Okay, so here comes the fun part. We're going to go ahead and solder on our little skulls onto the edges, okay? So we've got the solder on the backs. Kind of the idea here is I want to make sure, see if you can see this, I want to make sure that it's not butted right up against the bezel. And I would love to be able to fit these little filigree flowers on the inside. Maybe do some filigree, you know, like some bigger filigree around the outside that I made. These are from Janie Mills, by the way, on Etsy. So I kind of feel like that's a good spot. Now here's a trick to it. We're going to go ahead and tilt this up so that the apex of your curve right here is at the top. So it helps to get eye level, because otherwise it'll slide on you. Alright, make sure it's nice and level. There you go. Alright, next, flux the F-bomb out of it. You wouldn't believe the F-bombs involved in this project. I know I'm making it look easy, but don't worry, there's going to be bloopers. Now we'll grab our torch. We're going to go ahead and put the number 3 tip on it. Light her up. We're going to start from the inside and just glaze over your flux. I know that a lot of people worry about desoldering. I'm still using medium solder, by the way. Probably won't switch to easy until I get to the... Here we go. I probably won't switch to easy until I get to the flowers and then the ends. So now, because remember that's hot, so don't touch it. I know I keep telling you guys that, but I've made that mistake lots of times. So now we're going to go ahead and take our little skull, and we're going to line it up the best that we can. Now, you're welcome to go ahead and measure these. In fact, it's probably a really good idea, but I don't. I just eyeball it, and if it looks good, I'm happy. Don't forget that when your flux starts to cool off, it'll start getting gummy, which I'm using to my advantage right now. All right, now we're going to go ahead and solder it. Same tip, number 3. Start on the inside. You notice I'm really just focusing my heat underneath. I'm getting a little bit on the bottom, but I'm really just focusing my heat underneath where that skull is. A little bit on the bottom, because you do want that heat to rise up a little bit. And I'm going to draw it up a couple of times. Spin it around. After a bit, you're going to watch for that flux to start to glaze and bubble. A little bit, bring it up top. Watch your sterling. Does that stuff will melt. No. same thing like we did on the rails. So I've got the center of it, it's pretty well soldered on. I saw it flow. Now I'm going to focus a little bit more on the insides or on the outside. So I'm really keeping my heat underneath and right above the top of the skull. I'm going to bring it up over the top. There we go. Now if we flip it around, you're going to see it's popped up a little bit on the bottom. That's okay. You're going to have to fiddle with it a little bit. Make sure it's really flowing well. Watch your sterling. There we go. Now we're going to go ahead and let this cool down. You notice I didn't push the bottom in just yet? There's a reason for that. When I go to actually solder the bottom on, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to let this cool down before you quench it. Always, 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 when you're working on a big piece like this, let it cool down a little bit before you quench it. You can pluck it out, put it on a steel block like I like to do. Take it out of the annealing pan because that'll actually preserve the heat. So anyhow, then what we're going to do is we're just going to take a hammer and we're very, very gently over Joni's bracelet forming mandrel, and we're just going to tap that down, okay? Okay, so you notice that I've just quenched it, and it's not cool, or it's cool, but it's not pickled. And I'm not going to worry about that just yet. And all I'm going to do is give a couple light taps to the top, and then make sure that it's secure right up against the base here. This is what I do on a regular mandrel as well. If that's all you have, that'll work. I'm going to go all the way around the edge. And then double check, make sure that everything is pressed down against the bottom as close as you can get it. Because it's really only tacked on in one spot. And I don't have the bolts on this, really for a couple of reasons. I don't have the bolts on this because I want to be able to lift it up and get underneath it, pop it off easily. Okay, so now we're going to take it back and we're going to solder the rest of it back on. Okay, we're going to strike our torch up again, heat it up from the bottom. I gotta reheat this whole thing all over again. Notice I'm keeping it really away from the end, right? Just focusing straight on the bottom. Little top and bottom heat is always good for it. Gives a sterling silver a break. Once you see that solder flash, it should be good. That's soldered all the way on. And then we're going to do the next one. Okay, so now we're going to do the other side. Here's the deal. I didn't cool it off or anything. All I did was just kind of list it the way that I wanted it to be. Used some cross locks and twisted it. So I'm going to go ahead and get her started with some flux. Mostly because I'm a little bit lazy. So I'm going to go ahead and flux the crap out of it. Okay, get a really good look at your spacing with your other side. Like I said, you can mark it if you want to. So that's about there. We're gonna do the same thing on this side. Again, medium solder. Oops. Before we do that, let's go ahead and flow our flux. That way we get all the bubbling out of the way. This is going to need the same treatment. Looks pretty good. Alright. Straight the torch up. Do it again. So it shouldn't take quite as long. We're going to take it back over and do the same thing as we did the first time, okay? Alright, so the next step is to solder on this last little part right here, okay? So the first thing I'm going to go ahead and do is make sure that this right here, that the bottom is actually flush, okay? So hold it down. It's not going to take very much. Pretty good to me. Turn around to the other side. We got the eyes, everything soldered on. So the next step is to snip ourselves a little piece of sterling. So we're going to straighten it out as best as we can by hand. It's just a tiny little section. Don't forget, we're doing two of these. And try and get this exact as possible. Leave a little bit of length so that when you cut it, you can file it down. File it down on the ends, make sure it's nice and flat and straight. And make sure it fits. Okay, it's just a little bit long, I think. So we're going to file it down a little bit more. Just a hair more. There we go. So that fits in there nice and snug. And you do one more. Okay, so same thing, sweat solder, same thing we did on the front rails. And now we've got to make sure it's as level as we can get it. You'll see what happens, even if you're just a slightly bit off, it'll start to slide your end rail will. So I'm going to start on the inside here, but I'm not going to get too terribly close. Go on the inside. Watch that solder kind of glass over. I'm going to drop the heat up here underneath. Wait for that solder to flash. Take the heat away. Really, really, really careful. Watch your ends. Because these corners right here are really where it likes to melt. I think that'll almost do it. Okay. All the soldering is now officially complete. Thought about adding some more onto it and decided nah. I think keeping it simple will really bring out everything I really want everyone to see. Okay, so we'll cool it off and then pickle it.
This is it. It's finished. I like